The reason Class Enemy fascinated me so much is not just because of personal satisfaction and pleasure. It is because of theory. It is as if what I, for decades, tried to develop in my theoretical work finally found expression in cinema. Not in this primitive way that, oh, he illustrated Rock Beecek, what I wanted to say, but as a genuine, autonomous, cinematic experience. At what level? First, it's clear that this film, Class Enemy, is grounded in a deep personal experience. You can feel the real, something shocking must have happened in reality. Outside the film. But I think what makes the film really great is that we don't need to know what this real experience was, because Rock Beecek resisted this temptation to make it real, in the sense of this is not just a film, this is real life. No. The film fully stands on its own. And so what's the, for me, this is my personal reading, what's the message of the film? I think it's the best that I know, condensed critical confrontation with the paradoxes of what we usually refer to as our permissiveness, our postmodern, anti-authoritarian, permissive society. The film is really about the deadlock of this society and about a new figure of a master, in both meanings of the term. In English, the teacher and leading figure. A master which is not simply a bad master, but potentially a positive figure. Namely, what's our situation today? On the one hand, we have our daily life, our compromised life, where we are in a certain way free, but this freedom, of course, is not the authentic freedom, is this conformist freedom, things just go on with all compromises and so on and so on. In the film, the way I see it, this compromising attitude of our normal daily lives is embodied not so much in the high school students, but especially in the majority of the teachers. Then we have the rebellion. Pupils who rebel. The greatness of the film is to subtly, not so much denounce as bring out what is false in this kind of revolt, rebellion, but not, that's crucial, not in the sense of returning to some old patriarchal authoritarian values, claiming, you see, young people should not rebel, it's danger, it destabilizes love. No, it shows the authoritarian potential of rebellion itself. It shows the deadlock of rebellion. It shows how rebellion, and precisely I see the strike, the revolt of the student in the high school, as a reaction to the suicide of one of them, a girl. I see this rebellion as, of course, a condensed representation of 68, all other student rebellions, and so on and so on. The problem is, of course, and I remember this from my personal experience, again, the authoritarian potentials of this rebellion. It's just a blind attitude of rebellion, which does not bring authentic freedom. It appears as act of liberation, but it's just a new form of community, which in a way is even more authoritarian than the community against which students rebel. This new collective spirit of rebelling students is, this is demonstrated in a wonderful way, staged in the film, I think. How subtly this spirit of liberation resisting the oppressive authority of the adults and so on and so on, how it turns into a new form of authority, if for no other reason, for the obvious reason that the authorities represented in the film by teachers and so on, the authorities are no longer authentic authorities. They are this kind of a permissive liberal authorities and so on and so on. And so paradoxically, the rebellion is for me an authoritarian rebellion. It's mainly the rebellion against the main protagonist of the film, the teacher of German at this high school, whom the students blame for the suicide of one of them, of a young girl who was in deep crisis. And of course, the fact that this teacher is the teacher of German immediately evokes all these stupid bad taste associations. Yeah, German, Nazi-like terror authority. But in a very subtle way, the film undermines this reading, because yes, the teacher is the teacher of German. He even insists that whenever he speaks with students, they talk in German. But at the same time, his topic, when this teacher gives classes or when he talks with students, his main topic is Thomas Mann, the works of Thomas Mann. But as we know, the books of Thomas Mann were precisely burned by the Nazis. So again, what did, now slowly I'm approaching the central fact, what did shock me so much, shock me in a good sense, shattered me really in the film? It's how this teacher, which is first effectively presented, especially if one doesn't watch careful the film, as simply a figure of brutal authoritarian power, that it's something totally different. Yes, he is experienced as threatening, even violent. But why? I claim that he stands for the type of a master that we need today. He doesn't give any orders. He doesn't impose any ideas. As he himself says, the teacher, towards the end of the film, what he did to the young girl who committed suicide was not an injunction, orders, how to behave. To put it bluntly, he just confronted her with her own freedom. He pushed her into a situation where she was no longer able to take refuge in whatever old excuses, clichés, whatever. She had to decide. Literally, he called her to her own freedom, and she wasn't able to assume this freedom. Or, I leave this open, or maybe she did, and her suicide was an authentic act of freedom. But this doesn't matter. What matters for me is this, if I may escape into my philosophical generalities. Already Aristotle knew very well that in some sense a slave is more free than a master. Because a slave, when left to himself, as Aristotle says, is like an animal. A slave is the one who just follows his instincts, does whatever he wants, and when he obeys the master, it's just because of the external pressure of the master. While the master is someone who has to obey his own sense of duty, who is in this sense more under pressure, less free than a slave. But of course, this obeying your inner law, duty, is true freedom. And I claim the same thing happens today. We as consumerist subjects, we of course experience ourselves as free. But what is our actual freedom today? It's the consumerist freedom of choice. You can choose your profession, if, of course, you have a choice. You can choose your sexual orientation. You can choose how you will spend your holiday, whatever you want. But this is just the freedom of these small daily choices. This freedom is practiced within a certain social frame, which is less and less transparent to us, of which we know less and less. So the big, even political task today is how to make us aware that this daily freedom of making small free choices, I will go to a holiday to Greece or to Spain, I don't know, go to see this movie or that movie, I am gay or heterosexual, whatever. That these freedoms are not enough. The true freedom is the freedom to choose, to change the very frame, the very global situation which determines the options of our small freedoms. This more radical freedom again is more and more absent. And here I think we need some kind of a figure of a master whose function is not to give us orders. It's not the totalitarian master exemplarily as in Stalinism who knows better than ourselves what do we really want. Because that's the true totalitarian master. He doesn't give us orders like, it doesn't matter what you want, I will force you to do it, you have to obey me. No, the message of the true master is much more tricky, totalitarian master. It is, I know better than you what you really want, what is good for you. Or another version of a master we have today is the master who even doesn't want to appear as a master, is the expert. Economic expert, psychological expert. Again, he knows what's the best for you. But I claim there is a third figure of a master, the authentic master. Someone who just by his presence, his words, his acts, makes you fully aware of your own freedom. When you encounter such a person, you are deprived of any excuses. The message of this person to you is not obey me or whatever. The message of this person to you is, yes, you can do it. Don't escape from your freedom. You can decide. The choice is yours. He makes you literally aware of your freedom. I remember as an old Maoist, ex-Maoist, how, in spite of all the horrors of the Cultural Revolution, there was a moment of this even at the beginning of Chinese Cultural Revolution when Mao Zedong made that famous message to students, young people, telling them, you have the right to rebel. This is the function of the true master. For example, today, a true master is the one who would just tell you, no, we are not limited to the type of global consumerist technocratic capitalism that we have today. You can do it. You can question the basic coordinates of it and so on. Like, change is possible, but I will not tell you what change. It's up to you to choose. I just open up the space for your freedom. And I claim, for reasons into which I will not go now, that you need a master to do this, paradoxically. Somebody has to kick you, push you from outside, has to give you an instigation to become aware of your own freedom. And I think again that this is the function of the teacher in the film. He is just confronting everyone, professors, high school students, with their own freedom. And that's the message that we need absolutely today. This is, I claim, even the fundamental political message today, because what are our choices today? We have this liberal technocratic consumerism. Let's leave the economy to experts. Let's just stick to our daily pleasures. Then we have right-wing anti-immigration protests, which are a kind of a return to ancient figures of the master, authoritarian master, representative of national authority and so on, of national interests. This is also a fake today. We all know it. Then we have rebels, protesting students and so on. It's good, but I think that precisely in principle it's good, but I don't think their form of protest is enough. They don't have a program. It's just an expression of dissatisfaction. And I think in such a situation, we again need the figure of a master. That's the paradox that I see embodied in the film. Only a master, but again, not a master who gives you orders, but a master who, just in a way, by being there, by his precisely calibrated words, confronts you with your freedom. It's not a master who gives you a cover. Like, oh, it's not my responsibility, I was just obeying my master, you know, like Eichmann's excuse in Israel. I was just obeying Hitler's orders and so on and so on. No, 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 it's precisely the master who tells you, listen, you cannot take any cover. You are fully responsible for your what you do. That's why we are afraid of such a master. And again, this is for me the basic ethico-political predicament today. Our consumerism, predominant attitude, or our permissive consumerism, or on the other hand, our anti-immigrant, nationalism, populism, they are all for me forms of escape from this radical freedom. Which is why, if I may end up with a modest, of course, mockingly, Stalinist dream, I think this film, Class Enemy, should be shown in all schools, should become part of education. It should be shown in all high schools, maybe not elementary schools, it's too tricky, but high schools, so that I think people will become aware of the deadlock. It's much more than a film. It achieves this film almost the impossible. You know, from time to time, you get works of art, which are not only excellent as works of art, but they achieve to condense in a simplified situation the basic ethico-political choice alternative deadlock of an epoch. Like, as we all know, in ancient Greece, this was maybe, I'm not so sure, but let's say Antigone. The conflict was there, presented in a simple, clear way. We have other works of art of this, and I think, without being bombastic, without exaggerating, that Class Enemy precisely does this for us today. In a simple story, it confronts us with our basic predicament. For all of us, it's okay, we can abstract this, that, whatever, but if you, as they say, cut the bullshit, this is at its most elementary, in its basic form, this is our predicament. That's why I think this film, again, it's more than a classic, and it's more than a film, even more than a work of art. It's, in a way, for each of us, the encounter with our existential truth. And I think it's also even a lesson for Europe. Like, Europe is also avoiding a choice, a confrontation with its own freedom. We have technocratic Europe, where we say, okay, let's listen to the experts, do the austerity, blah, blah, everything will be okay. We have anti-immigrant Europe, we have the all too naively protesting Europe. No. We need the Europe itself to fully confront its freedom and to make its choice. I often refer here to Freud's well-known question from the end of his life, was will das Weib? What does a woman want? I think today the question is, was will Europa? What does Europe want? And that's what ultimately, if we take it seriously, this film confronts us with. So I claim it should be shown not also in all elementary school, but also in all European parliaments, especially in Strasbourg, in the big parliament, if they want to do their job properly. Now, today, world needs Europe more than ever. Because today, the new form of capitalism that is emerging, so-called Asian values, authoritarian capitalism, this is, for me, the danger. Capitalism, it looks so, no longer needs democracy. And Europe is now confronting a choice. Will it become just another domain in this new, more authoritarian global capitalism, or will it confront its freedom? And that's how I also read the title. The title, I don't take it in a naive way. First, of course, it's this obvious ambiguity, the title of the film, of course. Class enemy, in the sense of class in a high school, but also class enemy in the old Marxist sense and so on. But who is the class enemy? My formula would have been that precisely, far from being the class enemy, the teacher is the one who confronts us with the true struggle. The teacher is not the enemy. Only by confronting our freedom the way the teacher compels us can we really see who is the enemy, who is the friend. In other words, only in this way can we really see that all the three main existing options, anti-immigrant populist racism, simple liberal permissiveness, or a short-sighted pseudo-leftist, even I claim, protest, that they are not enough. So I genuinely think that beneath all the irony and so on, this film is an important contribution to and an element of class struggle. It's just shocking, and I think it's a miracle. You know, my definition of miracle is when you see a work of art and you ask yourself, but my God, how was something like that possible? Like the miracle of Shakespeare is, Elizabethan England was nonetheless a terrible place, poverty, struggles, corruption. How was a miracle like Shakespeare possible there? And especially today, especially with the political, ideological misery of, unfortunately, my own country, Slovenia, it's a miracle. How was such a film possible in Slovenia?